who've had children who've died from fentanyl poisoning. And these were just received in a few days. This doesn't even account for all the deaths that have been caused by this drug. According to the California Department of Public Health, fentanyl deaths rose in California by more than 400% between the years 2013 and 17. Zach Didier was a 17-year-old Rockland, California student. He was a track star, a straight-A student, a self-taught musician, and had a goal of one day going to Stanford. After watching a movie with his family, he went to bed after telling his father, "I had a good time. Love you, Dad. Good night." The next day, when Zach didn't answer a knock on his door, his dad entered his room and found the son he loved so much slumped over the computer keyboard at his desk, unresponsive. Zach bought what he thought was a prescription pain pill from someone he met on Snapchat. It turned out to be fentanyl, and it was a lethal dose. And now Zach's parents, like so many other, will never get to tell their child they love them again. When fentanyl first came into the United States, it was used by hardcore street users addicted to heroin. Now, the cartels are trying to draw in middle school kids, high school kids, college students, adults who've never used drugs or don't have an addiction problem. The synthetic fentanyl is sold illegally as a powder, it's dropped onto blotter paper, it's put in eyedroppers and nasal sprays, or made into pills that look like other prescriptions like Percocet or Xanax or Adderall. Fentanyl is 50 times stronger than heroin. It's so potent that an amount the size of 3 grains of sugar is lethal. This sugar packet that you'll find in any diner or any coffee store, half of this sugar packet is a lethal dose of heroin. Half of the sugar packet. You take out about 3 grains of this sugar, and that's a lethal dose of fentanyl. The reason fentanyl is becoming so popular with drug traffickers is it takes such a small amount to cause an effect similar to that of heroin. And a little fentanyl goes a long way and makes a whole lot of money. The problem is also that it's so potent that just a slip of a hand when you're mixing it, or residual dust of fentanyl in a blender that you're using to mix this up, results in a batch that can kill multiple users instantly. There's an emergency room physician and an addiction psychiatrist at the University of Michigan who said that he has documented cases where they have had to give a dose of Narcan, which is the drug used to reverse someone who's overdosed, or they've had to give someone Narcan 8 times to reduce the effects, 8 times. First responders are not equipped typically with that many doses of Narcan. It is not just hardcore drug users dying from fentanyl. It is moms, it is coaches, it is lawyers, pizza delivery guys, solar panel deliverers, you name it. It's affecting everyone. In 2016, Prince, musical genius in the industry, he died from taking counterfeit Vicodin that had fentanyl in it. And the rate of African-American deaths from fentanyl is growing the fastest. Between 2011 and 2016, the African-American death rate increased 140% each year. Fake fentanyl pills can be easily purchased by kids online using Snapchat or some other app, and it's delivered right to their home. You would never even know it. According to an NBC News report in January, federal authorities in Sacramento issued a multi-count indictment accusing 10 people from California and Nevada of trafficking in fentanyl-laced oxycodone pills. Prosecutors said wiretaps showed that the defendants were aware that multiple deaths in the Sacramento area had been linked to those pills, and they kept on selling them. In 2019, one of my constituents, Alexandra Capelluto, died after taking a pill that had 5 times the fatal amount of illicit fentanyl, a fact she had no idea of when she purchased that pill. She thought she was taking the pain reliever oxycodone. I have been working with her family and others over the last several months to craft a thoughtful proposal. SB 350 is based off of AB 2173, which was passed in 2004, which requires the court to advise an individual convicted of a DUI that drinking and driving could result in the death of another person, and if they continue this behavior and kill someone while driving under the influence of alcohol, they could be charged with murder. They could be charged with murder. Not necessarily, but they could be. SB 350 would require the same advisement be read to an individual convicted of manufacturing and distributing fentanyl. This bill will help provide the key element of implied malice for a prosecutor. Today marks 15 days to the day that Alexander Capoletta died from fentanyl. 15 months, sorry. Today also marks 6 months to the day that Alex Neville died from fentanyl. I would like to ask you now for your full attention, senators, as you listen carefully to the testimony of my two witnesses, Matt Capoletta, Alexandra's dad, and Amy Neville, Alex's mom, both of whom lost their children to fentanyl.
Matt? We're going to provide each witness 2 minutes for their testimony, 2 minutes apiece. Thank you.
It's up to you which one goes first, Matt.
Is it 2 or 2.5? I thought it was 5, sorry.
You to keep your mask on, please, above your nose.
I'm sorry, my glasses get fogged up. I'll do my best. My name is Matt Capoletta. I'm standing here before you today as the father of Alexandra, who was killed on December 23rd, 2019, by a counterfeit prescription pill which contained illicit fentanyl. Nothing we do here today will bring back my daughter or those we have already lost. I am here on behalf of the thousands who will be deceptively and fatally poisoned in the future if we don't take decisive action now. This bill has been drafted with one goal, to save lives. This legislation is not punitive, it's preventative. Modeled after the successful Watson rule, SB 350 provides drug dealers with a fair warning. It informs them that the drugs they are selling could result in someone's death. With fentanyl being sold under false pretenses to unwitting consumers, SB 350 is an appropriate response to a deadly threat. Before fentanyl emerged on the drug scene in 2013, drug dealers had some basis for claiming that they were not responsible for deaths that resulted from selling illicit drugs. However, this has changed. Today, people are being deceived, particularly when consuming counterfeit pills pressed to mimic legitimate pharmaceuticals. Instead, they contain nothing but a neutral base and fentanyl. This despicable act is being done solely for financial gain with reckless disregard for human life. Illicit fentanyl has done what no other black market drug has ever done. It kills with a single use. It is killing the casual drug user, the first-time drug user, and those self-medicating. This group of non-addicts is now the fastest growing and least recognized demographic for drug-related deaths in the US. Addicts are not immune from fentanyl either. Many are being robbed of their chance to recover. In this new era of illicit fentanyl, we must be capable of imposing serious consequences for those who continue to sell deadly drugs even after they know the dangers. Alexandra's law is a warning. If a dealer chose to ignore it, then prosecutors will have the discretion to impose a stiffer penalty. As a border state, California is a hub for illicit fentanyl distribution across this nation. We are obligated to take action. I ask that you pass this bill onto the full Senate for debate. Our children are dying, families are suffering, and we need your help now more than ever. We cannot bring Alex or the thousands we have already lost back, but her law will save others. As our leaders, your passage of this bill today will demonstrate your commitment to protect the citizens of California from this rapidly growing danger. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
My next witness is Amy Neville.
Good morning, Senators. Thank you for having me. My name is Amy Neville. I'm from Orange County. And this is my 14-year-old son, Alexander. Alexander died 9 months ago today on June 23rd, 2020, after taking a single pill that he believed was an oxycodone. It turned out to be a counterfeit pill made of fentanyl. I found Alex dead on the floor of his bedroom. This is how most of our kids are dying, in the night, alone in their bedrooms. Alex got his pill from a dealer he connected with on social media. We know who the dealer is. This dealer is still selling his drugs online. At least two other people have died from this dealer's counterfeit pills, one before Alex and one after. The young man that died before Alex died in front of the dealer in the dealer's apartment. Alex was duped by this drug dealer, and this is happening every day. Alex believed he was buying an oxycodone. That's what he intended to take, and he would be alive today, except for the fact that the dealer sold him fentanyl under false pretenses. Does this dealer know his pills are deadly fakes? If not, SB 350 will make sure he is informed just how dangerous his actions can be. If he does know, that is malice. He is not just a small-time street dealer, he is committing fraud and murder. Alexander's law gives law enforcement the tools to hold him accountable. Fentanyl changes everything. Its impact is felt in every county in this state, from the first-time user to those suffering with long-term substance use disorder. People are being poisoned by this deadly chemical. Fentanyl does not discriminate. It's killing every race, every gender, rich or poor, and it's killing our young people at disproportionate rates. And no one deserves to die this way. You might be asking yourself, so where is this drug dealer now? It should come as no surprise to you that he is free, living his life, continuing to sell drugs to unsuspecting kids and adults. Well, my child is in an urn on a shelf in his bedroom. The game has changed and we need new rules. SB 350 is a step in the right direction. It won't bring back my Alex, but it will surely save others. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to ask, are there any additional witnesses in support of SB 350 here in room 4203? If so, we would ask you to state your name and your position in this room. Just come to the microphone and state only your name and your position. We've already had primary testimony on the motion.
My name's Laura Didier. This is my son, Zachary Didier, and on his behalf, he was killed 3 months ago. I ask you to support this legislation.
Thank you. Next witness.
Good morning. My name is Cammie Velsey. This is my son, Emilio Stephen Velsey. He died on March 9th of 2020 at 19 years old. And I greatly support SB 350, and I ask that you do the same.
Thank you. Next witness.
Good morning. My name is Jaime Puerta. I'm here representing my dead son, Daniel Joseph Puerta Johnson, who died on April the 6th, 2020, due to fentanyl poisoning. He was only 16 and a half years old, and he's now gone. I strongly support SB 350. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Hello, thank you. My name is Ed Ternan. I lost my 22-year-old son to a counterfeit Percocet pill in May of 2020. I strongly support SB 350, which will reduce both drug deaths and drug-related incarcerations by providing a warning to first-time convicted offenders. I strongly urge you to support it.
Thank you. Next witness.
Hi, my name's Christine Capoluto, and this is my daughter, Alexandra Capoluto. And, you know, she had suffered insomnia home from college, just wanted to take half a pill as she got off Snapchat so she can sleep, and I found her dead in her bedroom in the morning. I urge you to support 350, please. We can't keep having these children die like this. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Good morning, Senators. My name is Steve Hilson. I'm a retired police officer from the city of San Bernardino. On January 22nd of 2020, my wife found my daughter, her boyfriend, dead in their apartment in the city of Redlands. There were two of four victims that were killed that day by fentanyl poisoning. We've carefully constructed this bill with the suggestion that a warning will be effective in trying to curb the scourge of this poison being spread throughout our society. I strongly support the bill and urge your support in honor of our children.
Thank you. Are there any additional witnesses here in 4203 wishing to speak in support of SB 350? Seeing none, now we'll move to room 2040. Are there witnesses in support? Again, we will state your name, your organization, and your position. Thank you.
Lisa Marquez, and this is my son, Fernando Sanchez, who's passed away on March 26, 2020, and I strongly suggest you support SB 350. He was my only child. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
I am Charlena Antunes. I'm here on behalf of my daughter, Athena Zepeda, that died November 7th of 2020, which was one of the six deaths in the same week in Harupa Valley Sheriff's due to fentanyl. I support strongly SB 350. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Good morning, Senators. First, I want to thank you for this opportunity today to speak to you. This is my beloved son, Christian Jack Taylor. He was only 21 when he passed on July 19th, 2020 from fentanyl poisoning. His toxicology came back pure fentanyl crushed with Tylenol. It was a pill that was sold to him as Percocet, but it had the five times legal dose of fentanyl and stronger than 50 times stronger than heroin. My son suffered from anxiety. He went to the doctors over a dozen times in the hospitals trying to get help for his anxiety, but they wouldn't prescribe him anything. He tried antidepressants, but he wasn't depressed. He was suffering from anxiety, and so he turned to drug dealers at his school campus. He was a senior at the University of Arizona, and he was going into his senior year to graduate this spring.
Thank you for your testimony.
Had his whole life ahead of him.
Thank you. We need to move to
Senators,
our next witness.
Can you imagine?
We need to move to our, I don't want to be insensitive, but we need to move to our next witness. We just need your position.
I strongly support this bill.
Thank you. Next witness, please.
Hello, My name is Laura, and this is my 16-year-old son, Joseph. Joseph was poisoned with fentanyl November 4th, 2020. Four months ago, it was my child. Tomorrow, it can be your child, your grandchild, or one of your loved ones. I strongly support SB 350, and I'm here representing Joseph, Izzy, and Paul. Their moms couldn't be here, but I'm here for them. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
My name is Mary Ternan, and I'm Charlie Ternan's mom. Charlie died on May 14, 2020. He took what he thought was a Percocet for his bad back, but it turned out to be a counterfeit and poisonous pill that was made of fentanyl, we call fentapil. Please vote for this very important bill so other children don't have to die. I'm in strong support of SB 350. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Hi, my name is Lisa Witcherly, and I'm here to represent my daughter, Lacey Witcherly, that will forever be 20 because she was poisoned by fentanyl August 25th, 2019. She did not want to die. I strongly support SB 350.
Thank you. Next witness.
Current senators, I'm Jim Schultz here on behalf of my son, Nick. Nick was poisoned by one half tablet of a pill containing fentanyl in June of last year. He would have been 26 today. As Senator Melendez stated, this problem is growing exponentially. I respectfully ask that you use your power today to get SB 350 out of committee with an aye vote. You will absolutely, absolutely save lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness. Are there any additional witnesses in 2040 in support of SB 350? Seeing no one coming forward, moderator, we'll now move to the phone lines. Can you let us know how many callers we have in queue in support of SB 350, and we'll begin with testimony.
Mr. Chair, we have 7-8 phone lines in queue to speak to the bill. And pardon me, I stand corrected, Mr. Chair. The number of participants attempting to queue up to speak is growing quickly. We are now at 20. We'll go to line 159. Please go ahead. Pardon me just a moment, please. Line 159, if you can hear me, please speak. Just a moment. Pardon me, Mr. Chair. We're going to go to line 181.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, this is Shannon Knox. I'm with Community Health Project Los Angeles, and we want to strongly oppose this bill as we do not believe that it addresses the situation at hand.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are only at this time taking people who wish to comment in support of the bill. We're going to go to line 87. Pardon me, just a moment. We're going to go to line 19.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, this is Natasha. So you're saying that you're taking in support, but I'm in opposition. This is Natasha.
We're going to go to line 17.
Hello, Senators. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, my name's Timothy Martin, and I'm here in support of Alexander Neville. He's my nephew, and I appreciate your support of SB 350. I feel it's a warning to anybody who sells illegal or legal drugs laced with fentanyl. I feel it establishes, you know, that human life has value, and we should at least, at the very least, give them a warning that maybe in the future, when they kill somebody, there could be consequences. I appreciate your support and time. Thank you.
Line 88.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Corinne Metters, and I'm calling from El Dorado Hills. I am a concerned parent and a friend of Laura Didier, mother of Zach Didier. As it stands right now, in this moment, drug cartels like the Sinaloa cartel have the upper hand, and the wave of fentanyl poisonings in the Northwest are directly linked to this, to them. You know it, and so does the DEA. It's becoming a national and global problem. Senators, you have the wherewithal to lead the way most effectively by passing this bill. Please do the right thing for our families. Your ability.
To our callers, please, at this time, we need to have just your name, your agency, and whether or not you support or oppose the bill. At this time, we're taking in support, please.
Line 12. Pardon me, just a moment. We're going to go to line 116.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Sarah Frankowitz. I'm testifying on behalf of my son and best friend, Israel Izzy Ryland Frankowitz. He died March 11th, 2020, 30 days before his 19th birthday, and I'm in strong support of the bill. And I beg that you be the same. Thank you.
Thank you. Next
line
caller.
30.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
My name is Brooke Capolito. I'm calling on behalf of my little sister, Alexandra Capolito, who is dead from fentanyl. I am in full support of this bill, and I beg that you support it too, so other families don't have to go through the pain and the hurt that we have. Thank you.
Line 18.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Tina Pruitt, and I am calling about my son, Logan Albert Harris, who just turned 22. October 1st of 2020, a fentanyl pill killed my son. And I am in support of this, and I beg you to act now. I beg you to do something to protect the public and to save other lives.
Line 135.
Madam Chair and members, Lieutenant Brandon Epp on behalf of the LA County Sheriff's Department in support.
Line 101.
My name is Jennifer Bryant. I'm here today for my son, Landon Jack Marino, who was poisoned with fentanyl on February 20th. 2020. I fully support this bill, and I pray that you will too. Thank you.
Line 121.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Kate Rogers, and
line 121, we're sorry, your line cut out. I'm going to go to line 182.
There? Hello, are you still there? I wanted to make the point that my son died in December of 2017. I wanted to make the point that according to the National Institutes of Health, 47% of all 12th graders in this year have tried some form of illicit drugs. Now, that category does not include things like marijuana. So what we're talking about is a roulette game where one out of every two kids is going to be exposed to the type of danger of an illicit fentanyl.
The caller, we've had our two lead witnesses speak, and I apologize, but at this time, due to the restrictions under COVID-19, we're only limited at this time with speakers in support.
and we just need you at this time to state your name, the agency that you're representing, and whether or not you're in support of the bill. I apologize.
Line 182. Pardon me, just a moment. I apologize. Just a moment. We're going to go to line 188.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
This is John Lovell. I represent the California Narcotic Officers Association, the California College and University Police Chiefs Association, and the Coalition of Public Safety Officers Support Services. We incorporate by reference all of the eloquent testimony before us. This is a good sense bill, and we commend Senator Melendez for coming forward with this. We strongly, strongly support.
Line 16.
Yes, this is Chris Buffard. I'm a deputy district attorney in Riverside County. I'm here to support the bill, but also to offer any technical assistance that the committee needs. Thank you.
Line 49. Line 49, your line is open. We have to move on to line 70. Line 70, your line is open. And pardon me, we are now going to move on to line 196. Line 196, your line is open.
Thank you. This is Debbie and Kevin Ternan in support of our loving nephew, Charlie, who died of fentanyl poisoning. Please support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 104. 104. We are going to move on to line 114.
Oh, hello. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
114, yes.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Please go ahead.
This is Yolanda. My name is Yolanda Smith, and I'm fully in support of this bill. Please support it to help save lives. My
line 164.
Hello, my name is Mercedes Diaz. I'm the grandparent of Christian James Hinojosa, who passed away January 16th of 2021. My grandson had direction. He just graduated from high school, got his new job, and he passed away. And from taking a pill to find out from the coroner, it was completely 100% fentanyl. I'm begging you guys to please, please, I'm in support of SB 350. It must pass. Thank you.
Line 153. Line 153, your line is open.
Thank you. My name is Gabby Hidalgo. My nephew was poisoned by fentanyl 3 months before his 21st birthday, and I strongly support SB 350.
Line 169. We're going to go on to line 22.
Hi, my name is Ruth Fritz. I'm in strong support of SB 350. My nephew Noah died of fentanyl last April 11th. Please pass this to save lives. Thank you.
Line 89.
Hi, my name is Perla. My son Daniel Elijah Figueroa died September 16th. 2020, he was poisoned by fentanyl in the form of a prescription pill. I am in full support of SB 350. Please support it as well. Thank you.
12.
Hello, my name is Aldo Mendoza. I am calling on behalf of my son, Daniel Elijah Figueroa, who was 20 years old, died of fentanyl poisoning. I am in support for SB 350, and I hope you are too. It will save lives. God bless you.
Line 159.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Virginia Krieger. I'm with Parents Against Illicit Narcotics. And on behalf of our thousands of members, we are strongly in support of Senate Bill 350, which will save lives. Thank you.
Line 105, line 105.
Hi, my name is Deborah Barada, and my nephew died of fentanyl poisoning, and I am in support. That is the 350.
Line 27.
Hi, my name is Sky Capoluto, and I'm in support of this bill on behalf of my sister Alex that I lost.
Line 75.
Hello, yes. My name is Graciela Baez. I'm a mother of Arnold Ceballos. Support SB 350. I want you senators to support us, make justice for my son, Arnold, who lost his life on November 1st, 2020, and all that lost lives due to fentanyl poisoning. It only takes 2 grams, milligrams for a person to be poisoned. I strongly support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 38.
My name is Melissa Martin. My nephew is Alexander Nephew, who died at 14 on June 23rd, 2020, and I support SB 350.
Line 94. Line 94, your line is open.
Is that me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, sorry about that. I'm Aaron Neville. And I'm here on behalf of my son, Alexander Neville. He was barely 14 years old. He passed away on June 23rd, 2020. And I'm in support of the bill, especially in regards to the evidence that, as far as how this is dealt with in places like Portugal and Oregon, where they have decriminalized youth.
We're going to move on to line 193.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Sabrina, and I'm in support of this bill because of my cousin Michael, who passed away 2 years ago.
Line 165.
Yes, hi. My name is Tony Barada, and I am in strong support of this bill on behalf of my nephew Michael, who is dearly missed. Please, please support this bill. Thank you.
Line 199.
Good morning, Lieutenant Shalisa Williams, San Bernardino Sheriff's Department, on behalf of Sheriff McMahon, in strong support.
Line 26.
Oh, hi. Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, my name is Madison, and I'm in full support of the bill.
Line 194.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Meredy Pesci, and I strongly and passionately support this bill on behalf of Emilio Velchi and the Velchi family.
Line 207. Line 207, your line is open.
Yes. Hi, my name is Lupe Garcia. I lost my nephew, Arnold Ceballos, on November 1st, 2010, to fentanyl poisoning. I strongly support SB 350.
Line 51.
Hello, my name is Faith Wayne. I'm calling on behalf of my son, Gavin K. Wayne, who died at the age of 24 with what he thought was a half of a Xanax. And as it turned out, it was fentanyl poisoning. I'm in strong support of SB 350. Thank you for your time.
Line 82.
Hi, my name is Douglas Wayne. My son Gavin died on January 2nd of this year from fentanyl poisoning. And we support SB 350. Please vote yes.
Line 152.
Hi, my name is Gabe Jimenez. I'm calling on behalf of my son, Jacob Gabriel Jimenez, who was poisoned by fentanyl on September 28th, 2020. I strongly support SB 350 and I urgently ask you to do the same and vote yes. Thank you.
Line 200.
Good morning. I'm Jill Badusik. I am with the Alexander Neville Foundation. I am also a current law enforcement employee, of officer of 21 years. I strongly support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 39.
Hi, my name is Roger Collington. I am calling on behalf of my stepson, Spencer Newsom, who died of fentanyl poisoning in September of 2020, and I strongly support SB 350, and committee members request that you please do the same.
The charge is like half.
Line 95.
I did.
Line 95, hello, your line is open. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Maria Ortega. I'm with, we live in West Covina, California. I represent my son, Adrian De Jesus. He passed away February 11th, 2020. My son was murdered by fentanyl poisoning. He thought he was taking a Percocet for his insomnia, but was given a fake fentanyl pill. Me and my family support SB 350, and I beg you to pass and support SB 350, Alexander's law. It is only an advisory, just like the drinking and driving law. I beg you to protect our youth, because this law will not save my son's life, but it may save yours. Please, please support it. Thank you so much.
Line 182.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. Corey Salzillo on behalf of the California State Sheriff's Association in support of the bill. Thank you.
Line 79.
Hello?
79, yes, your line is open.
Hi, my name's Melissa Nunez. My little brother passed away on February 11, 2020. He was only 19 years old. He thought I was taking a Percocet, and he was poisoned by fentanyl. I beg you to please pass this law, and I fully support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 76.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello? Can you,
yes.
Hi, my name is Edith Gonzalez, and I'm calling on behalf of Adrian De Jesus. He died by being poisoned by fentanyl on February 11, 2020. He was like a son to me. My daughter's best friend. She is devastated, and now she can't sleep. She's so depressed and has anxiety now. She misses him so much. I beg and I support SB 350 law, please.
Line 83.
Hi, this is Laura Collington calling in support of SB 350 on behalf of my son, Spencer Newsom, who was murdered by fentanyl on September 21st, 2020. In Roseville, California. Thank you. Please support SB 350.
Line 104. Line 104, your line is open.
104?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear? Okay, sorry.
Yes.
My name is Jennifer O'Keefe, and I'm speaking on behalf of Spencer Newsom, who died of fentanyl poisoning on September 21st, 2020. Please pass this bill. I strongly support SB 350.
Line 211.
Hello, my name is Elise Erstenberger. I'm a pediatrician in Placer County who's cared for children exposed to opioids. I'm also a friend of the Didier family who lost 17 years back on December 27, 2020 to a fentanyl poisoning. I strongly support Senate Bill 350. Please vote yes.
Line 203.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
My name is Claudia Posada, on behalf of Daniel Johnson Puerta, and I
I am with SB 350.
Line 86.
Hi, my name is Kim Vandermeeden. I support SB 350 in honor of my son, Richard Vandermeeden, and his six friends that also have died from fentanyl poisoning in an 8-month period time frame in Rockland, California. Please support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 157.
Hi, my name is Vanessa Casilla, and we lost my cousin Elijah Figueroa in September at the age of 20, and I am in support of SB 350.
Line 106.
Hello, my name is Joanna Ortega, representing my cousin Adrian De Jesus, who passed away February 11th, 2020. He was murdered by fentanyl poisoning. I urge your senators to have your support in this bill in the honor of thousands who have died. We need your support to save lives. I am full support of SB 350. Thank you.
Line 77.
Hi, I'm Danielle Flosby, and I'm calling on behalf of the Capoluto family who lost their daughter, Alexandra, to fentanyl poisoning. And as a concerned citizen, I highly support SB 350.
Line 92.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, can you hear me? Hi, my name is Susana Rincon, and I'm calling on behalf of the Mendoza family. They lost their son, Daniel Elijah Figueroa, in September 2020 due to he was poisoned by fentanyl. I strongly support SB 350, and I urge you to do the same. Thank you for your time.
Line 184.
Hi, my name is Liz Murillo. I'm representing Fernando Sanchez, a 17-year-old boy who lost his life in Gilroy, California on March 26, 2020. I strongly support SB 350, and I ask each of you to do the same.
Line 61.
I heard you.
Line 61,
hello?
Your line is open. Hi.
My name is Jessica Zapata, and I'm in support of SB 350 on behalf of my nephew, Fernando Sanchez, who passed away 1 year ago this Friday. Thank you.
Line 161.
Hi, my name is Priscilla Deguin, and I'm calling on behalf of Lisa Marquez, who lost her only son March 26, 2020. To fentanyl poisoning, and I support SB 350.
Line 120.
Hi, my name is Torres. I'm calling on the Capoluto family who lost their daughter, Alexandra Capoluto. I'm in full support of the bill, SB 350.
Line 219. Line 219, your line is open. We're going to move on to line 145.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. My name is Eden Neville. I am here on behalf of my big brother, Alexander Neville. He took a single pill of what he was told was an oxycodone, and it happened to contain enough fentanyl to kill four people, and I strongly support this.
Line 217. Line 217.
Hello. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Can you? My name is Christopher John Didier, and I am the father of Zachary John Didier. I'm a retired military veteran. And on December 27th, 2020, I discovered Zach having been poisoned with fentanyl. I strongly, strongly support SB 350. Tomorrow is Zach's 18th birthday, and I plead and beg the committee to grant him a birthday present and save the lives of other youth in our country. Thank you.
Line 51.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Harper Wayne. I'm calling in support of my brother, Gavin Wayne, who died on January 2nd of 2021. We strongly support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 134.
Hi, my name is Renee Christensen. I'm calling in support of my dear friends, the Didier family. I'm also a mom of two young people and had no idea this was an issue. It's something we all need to know about, including those selling these counterfeit pills. Please support 350. Thank you.
Line 48.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
This is Marilyn Vasquez. I'm speaking on behalf of my beloved son, Jacob, who passed away November 28, 2020, after taking a fake Xanax. I strongly support SB 350.
Line 26.
Oh, my name is Lauren Bowser, and I support SB 350.
Line 12.
Hello, good morning. My name is Molly Aldridge, and I'm here on behalf of my son, Gavin Battle, who was poisoned with fentanyl on January 5th, 2021. I am begging you all to please support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 61. Pardon me. We'll have to move on to line 76. Line 76, are you there?
Mm-hmm. Hello?
Please respond.
Hi, my name is Kimberly Fuentes. I'm calling to say I support SB 350. Hello?
Thank you. Then we'll go on to line 229.
My name is Richard Badusek. My grandson is Alexander Neville, and I highly support this bill. We need to do something about what's happening to our children, and this is a good start. Thank you.
Line 231.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm Sam Didier. I'm calling on behalf of my brother, Zachary Didier, who has passed away. I won't be able to attend his wedding or his graduation, but I did attend his funeral. I'm in strong support of SB 350, and I don't know what other than a parade of grieving families can convince you if you're still not. So please have an open mind and let this bill go through. Thank you.
Line 70. Line 70, your line is open.
I realize that it's not.
We have to move on to line 76. Line 76, your
Hello.
Line is open.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello? Hi, I'm calling on behalf of Adrian de Jesus, my cousin, who was only 19 years old, and I'm calling to support Bill SB 250.
Line 70.
Just say hello, can you hear me every single time? That's what I did. On
line 70, your line is open. We're going to move on to line 61. Pardon me. Going to attempt line 45. Just a moment. Line 45, your line is open.
Hi. I'm calling in support of my little brother, Michael Nicholas Toronto. He died at the age of 23. Today is actually his 24th birthday. So I am in full support of SB 350. Thank you.
Line 235.
Hi, my name is Jennifer Alarcón, and I am in strong support of SB 350 in honor of Arnold Ceballos, who was poisoned by fentanyl. Thank you.
Line 232.
Hello, my name is Marianne Frosch. I'm in full support of this bill for Alexandra Capoluto, my daughter's sister. Thank you.
Line 236.
Hi,
Hi, my name is Lacey DiPolito. I'm here representing my son, Hayden Christian DiPolito, who passed away from fentanyl toxicity on May 31st, 2020. He received a pill that he thought was a oxy from a friend 2 days after graduation. I support SB 350. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, we have no one else that signaled that they wish to speak.
Moderator, would you check the lines one more time to see if there's any additional witnesses in support of SB 350?
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a final call for those who wish to speak in support of this bill. Please press 1 then 0. We'll call upon you by your line number. We're going to go to line... Pardon me, just a moment. We have more people queuing up. Just a moment, Mr. Chair. I'm going to go to line. Pardon me. Going to go to line 70. Line 70, your line is open.
Hi, this is Karen Fedusek. I am in support of SB 350. Please, senators, this fentanyl is a crisis and is running rampant. I lost my grandson, Alexander Neville, in June. Please pass this bill.
Line 241. Line 241, your line is open.
Hi, yes. On behalf of the Garcia family, we would like to support SB 350 in honor of Agno Ceballos. Thank you.
Line 57.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Lisa Jimenez, calling on behalf of my son, Jacob Jimenez. He died September 2020. He was murdered by fentanyl. And I hope you will do the right moral thing and vote yes on SB 350 as I will. Thank you.
Line 238.
Hi, my name is Autumn Davis, and I'm here on behalf of Alexander Johnson and Zach Como. They were all... and I support SB 350 and beg you to vote for it.
And as a reminder to any of our co-hosts who are still on the line, please use your mute button at this time. Line 228.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Victoria Antonez. My sister, Athena Zapata, died November 7th, 2020. She was 20 years old. Her life was cut short. I'm in full support of SB 350. I pray that you guys see this as an issue and that you do something about it. Thank you.
Line 220.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello? Hi, my name is Luke Frosch. I'm calling on behalf of Alexandria Capoluto. I'm the uncle of her daughter, and I'm in full support of SB 350 and urge you to support it also.
Line 227.
Larry Moores, California District. In support of the bill.
Line 223.
Hi, my name is Cindy Sorontos. I'm calling on behalf of my son, Dylan Sorontos, 18 years old, who was poisoned by fentanyl and passed away on May 8th, 2020. I strongly support SB 350. Thank you.
Line 215.
Hello. My name is Julie May, and I am the mother of Jessica Ann May, whom I found dead on the morning of February 15th, 2020. I am in complete support of SB 350. Thank you.
Line 209.
Hello? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm Pierre Joubert. I'm ringing up to give my full support to SB 350. My son, Alexander, passed away in July of last year from being poisoned to death by fentanyl. So I really do hope that this bill gets passed.
Line 66.
My name is Kay Scholes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. My name is Kay Scholes. I'm here for my son, Nicholas Scholes, who passed away June 26. I'm also an emergency room nurse that's made too many determination of death calls with our EMS partners for fentanyl poisoning. Way too many. Please, I strongly support this bill.
Line 212.
Hello, my name is Mac Black. I am here on behalf of my close friend, Dylan Sorontos, who passed away on May 8, 2020. I encourage you to listen to us and please pass SB 350. It would mean the world to all of us grieving families. Thank you.
Line 216.
My name is Mona Leonardi. My son, Michael Leonardi, was murdered February 24th of 2020 at the age of 20 years old while away at college in San Diego by a drug dealer who sold him a fake Percocet through Snapchat, but it was really fentanyl. I am in full support of SB 350 and beg you to support. Thank you.
Line 222.
Good morning. This is Maria Donia, and I'm calling in support of my dear friend, Tina Burke. She lost her son. Her son was killed and poisoned by fentanyl in July of 2020. Please, we have to protect our kids. Pass this bill. Thank you.
Line 77. Pardon me, just a moment. Line 77. Line 77, your line is open.
Hello?
Your line is open. We're going to move on to line 49. Line 49, your line is open.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
We need to make this 50 times more risky for these dealers. My name is Joseph Moritz. I have four 20-something daughters. We don't need a personal death in the family to see that we need to support SB 350.
Line 188. Line 188, your line is open. We have to move on to line 239. Line 239, your line is open. Pardon me, that line is not available. Going to go to line 225.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Yvette Castile, and I'm calling on behalf of Athena Zepeda, and I support SB 350.
Line 185.
Hello, my name is Carol Schweigert. I am calling in support of SB 350 on behalf of all of the victims and the families that are suffering from this. including mine and my son, who took what he thought was a Percocet while he's recovering from surgery, and it was fentanyl. So I'm in support of 350. Dealers have to be held accountable.
Line 169. Line 169, your line is open. We're going to move on to line 82.
My name is Joel Wayne. My grandson, Gavin, died earlier this year from fentanyl poisoning in Ventura County, and he was a beautiful California boy. Please support SB 350.
Line 204.
Hi, my name is Eric Steiger. I'm representing my son, Dylan Steiger, who passed away March 24th, 2020. Tomorrow would be 1 year. I strongly support SB 350. I encourage anyone and everybody to get out and get this passed. Thank you.
Line 242.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members. Ryan Sherman with the Riverside Sheriff's Association. And also with the California Coalition of School Safety Employees, Anna and Palos Verdes Police Officers Association, and Los Angeles School Police Officers Association, strong support of SB 350. Thank you.
Line 236.
Hi, my name is Lacey DiPolito. I support SB 350. I am here for my son, Hayden DiPolito, age 17, who passed away from fentanyl poisoning. Thank you.
Line 249.
Hello, Chair Bradford, Vice Chair, and committee members. My name is Jennifer Kennedy. I am a friend of the Didier family and Zach Didier, who died 3 months ago from fentanyl poisoning. I support SB 350, and I ask you, the honorable senators, to support this bill. Please be leaders on this important issue. Thank you.
Line 253. Line 253, your line is open.
Yes. Hello?
Yes.
Yes, my name is Michelle Sample. I'm from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. My son, Noah Spangler, came to Riverside to go to Teen Challenge. He was there, graduated over 14 months, lived a year sober, tried it once, and died. Please pass SB 350. My son and my daughter are here also. They also. Please pass this bill. Please.
Line 254. Pardon me, we was not able to access that line. We're going to go to line 261. Your line is open.
Hello, could you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, thank you guys for your time. I'm calling because my godson, Daniel Elijah Figueroa, was a star athlete, had a promising future, and died in October 2020 from fentanyl cell. My name is Ruby Gutierrez, and I am in support of SB 350, and I ask that you guys join us. Thank you.
Line 264.
Sure. Yo. Oh, this is Rene Aguilera. I'm here for support for Tina Zapita and her family. And I hope you guys pass that bill, man. SB 350.
Line 269. Line 269, your line is open.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. My name is Rosemary Pignol. I'm calling on behalf of my grandson, Isaiah Zay Gonzalez, who passed away January 10th, 2021. Due to fentanyl, he was not a user. tried it once and passed away. I am in full support of SB 350 on the behalf of our family, Gonzalez Pino and Caballero family. And I thank you, and I hope that you do the same.
Line 273. Just a moment. Line 276. Line 276, your line is open.
I'm
line 278.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Vanessa Snyder. I am in full support of 350. Last year, I lost three of my friends to being two of my best friends to it, and their families, and I. We hope you guys do pass this bill. Thank you very much.
Line 76. Line 76, your line is open.
Go, Marlene.
Move away a little bit.
Hi, my name is Marlene Villa, and I lost my brother, Adrian De Jesus, on February 11th, 2020. He was murdered by fentanyl. I'm begging you to pass Alexandra Law, SB 350. It's the only advisory, just like drinking and driving law. I beg you to protect our youth, because this law will not save brother's life, but it will save yours. Thank you.
Line 187.
Hi, my name is Terry Almanza. I am the mother of the late Sydney Sherrigan and the founder of Drug Induced Homicide Foundation. I am in full support of SB 350. Thank you, Senator Melendez.
Line 292.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Veronica. I am calling on behalf of Athena Zepeda. I'm praying, and I strongly suggest that you please pass the S350. Thank you.
Line 290.
My name is Tash Allen. I am the president and CEO of the International Faith-Based Coalition, and I stand in strong support of this bill.
Line 280.
Hello?
Hi.
Hi, yes. My name is Marissa Caballero. I'm calling on behalf of my son, Isaiah Gonzalez, who passed away on January 10, 2021, at 15 years old, due to fentanyl poisoning. I strongly support SB 350.
Line 295.
Hello, my name is Ruben Rodriguez. And I lost my nephew back in November 1st of 2020 due to fentanyl poisoning. I'm in support of SB 350. And please pass this bill so these criminals can pay for the poisoning of our communities.
Line 297.
Hi, my name is Anna.
Can you hear me?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
My name is Anna Estrada. I'm calling on behalf of Athena Zepeda. I agree with Bill SB 350 for We the People.
extent of our calls of opposition and support. If so, let's move to our callers in opposition of SB 350. Moderator, please cue those callers.
Mr. Chair, I apologize. We do have one additional person.
Okay. We'll take that one additional, we'll end there, and then we'll move to opposition. Thank you.
Line 293. Line 293, your line is open. And we're going to conclude. Mr. Chair?
All right. Are we moving now to witnesses in opposition? We'll move back to the committee room. And are there anyone present in 4203 who's in opposition of SB 350? Seeing none, let's move now to room 2040. Is there anyone in the room 2040 in opposition of SB 350? Seeing no one come to the microphone, now we'll move to... Oh, yes, we're going to move to our primary witnesses. I apologize. Our two primary witnesses in opposition to SB 350, we have Lieutenant Diane Goldstein, and then we have Glenn Backus. So we will start with Lieutenant Goldstein, please, in opposition. You have 2 minutes each.
Thank you to the distinguished members of this committee. On behalf of myself, my brother who died from an overdose, and the Law Enforcement Action Partnership, a nonprofit group of police, judges, and other criminal justice professionals who endorse evidence-based public safety policy, I am here in opposition to SB 350. There is no evidence that long prison sentences or even advisement save overdose lives. Higher-level drug manufacturers and dealers are rarely connected directly to the end user, meaning many drug users purchase from a friend or family member. Many of these transactions occur not between a ruthless cartel member and a vulnerable person with substance use disorder, but rather between two vulnerable individuals with substance use disorder. The harsh punishments favored by this bill would fall hardest on people who are selling small amounts of drugs towards their own drug problem. Rather than throw more money at punishing individuals who need help, we should be investing in real solutions that improve access to harm reduction services and substance use disorder treatment. I spent 20 years as a police officer, and my priorities have always been aligned with protecting the health and safety of my community. As I watched my own brother struggle with substance use disorder, I came to understand that our reliance on baseless, excessive criminal punishment, the war on drugs, is actually fueling our overdose crisis. By focusing on punishment, we are ignoring the reality that drug use is a health issue, not a criminal problem. My brother spent time incarcerated. He also tragically passed away before he got the help he needed and deserved. I am so sorry, and I hear the pain of every family member who has lost their loved one. I feel angry after losing my brother as well. I desperately wanted to blame someone for my brother's death, but I knew that sending the person who gave him the drugs to prison wasn't going to bring him back. Instead of blaming those who are living on the fringes of society, I choose to place blame on policies that endanger our health and safety. HB 350 is one such policy that has no place in an effective justice system. And again, my deepest condolences to every family member here. It brought up some tremendous pain that myself as a sister and the pain I saw my mother go through. I live it every single day. I respectfully ask for a no vote. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you. Next witness in opposition of SB 350.
Good afternoon. Glenn Backus representing Drug Policy Alliance and National Harm Reduction Coalition in opposition. This discussion is full of sadness for those of us who've lost loved ones and close friends to drug overdose. The crises of widespread drug misuse and the high rates of drug overdose are public health issues. And the stated intent of this legislation is to put people who sell drugs in prison for longer periods of time. But putting more people in prison for longer periods of time will not ameliorate the public health crises. The history of the drug war has already proven that. In the United States, including California, we pursued a policy of locking up millions of our citizens in an effort to stop the use of drugs. The result was one of the highest incarceration rates in the world, and drugs that are more widely available, cheaper, and more deadly than any time in our history. The drug war also taught us that laws like these contribute to racial disparities and incarceration. Punitive laws may look race neutral on their face, but due to disparate patterns of policing, charging, and sentencing, they always fall most heavily on Black, Latinx, and Indigenous individuals, families, and communities. As a public health matter, it is likely this bill will make the problems of overdose worse, not better. Surveys of witnesses to drug overdose have said over and over that the fear of police and prosecution is the number one reason why they don't call 911 or take a friend to the ER. Lastly, our public dollars are not unlimited, and there are better investments to save lives. The approximate per capita cost of 1 year in a California prison is now over $112,000 per year. For the same amount of money, we could send an additional 17 people to methadone treatment for a year, or 19 people to buprenorphine treatment. More people in treatment will save lives. More people in prison will not. The evidence is clear. We should stop spending on cruel and failed incarceration policies and invest in treatment and harm reduction, housing and health care, in order to preserve and protect life. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to try this once again. We're going to go back to this room again and make sure I'm not missing one. 4203 in opposition, seeing none, and 2040 in opposition of SB 350, seeing none. Now, moderator, we will go to the phone lines for those in queue who are in opposition of SB 350.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And again, ladies and gentlemen, we want to stress that this is for those who are speaking in opposition. We're going to go to line 173.
Hi, my name is Jessica Smith. I'm the Community Mobilization Coordinator with National Harm Reduction Coalition. I also formerly ran a surrender services program in rural Northern California. I'm calling in opposition to SB 350. Laws like this do not help prevent overdose, and they disproportionately impact street-level dealers, people who use drugs, and people of color. Thank you.
Line 201.
Hi, my name is Jenna Haywood. I'm a former opiate injection user, and I work with the National Harm Reduction Coalition. We need better prevention and education. SB 350 is not the solution to the overdose crisis. I'm in strong opposition.
Line 176.
Hi, my name is Savannah O'Neill, and I'm the Associate Director at National Harm Reduction Coalition. I am calling in opposition to SB 350. I've lost many friends to overdose, and I deeply get wanting to do something to address these preventable deaths, but this isn't it. There's no evidence that harsher sentences reduce deaths or using drugs. Please oppose SB 350.
Line 305. Line 305, your line is open. We're going to move on to line 307.
Okay. Hello?
Line 307, your line is open.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Lindsay, go. My name is Lindsay Kimball. I am hoping for the SB 350 in honor of the FEMA Zepeda who passed away from the fentanyl.
Line 309.
Hi, my name is Irene Ramirez, and I strongly support 350, so I am in support for this. I had a little cousin who OD'd from fentanyl, and I think we need to move forward with 350. Thank you.
Line 172.
Moderator, we're looking for witnesses in opposition to this measure.
Yes, Mr. Chair. And again, ladies and gentlemen, I want to stress for those speaking in opposition, this is their opportunity only at this time.
Yeah, this is Maddie Hyatt from the California Civil Liberties Advocacy. We also are in opposition to this. For the same reasons as many of our colleagues in opposition, we feel this is just perpetuating the war on drugs, and this is not the way to solve the fentanyl problem. We are sincerely sorry to all the victims, though.
Line 195.
Good morning. My name is Alejandra Cabral. I'm a doctoral student at the UCLA Fielding School of Public Health, and I strongly oppose the SB 350. We need evidence-based solutions backed by research in public health, not this. I strongly urge you to oppose SB 350.
Line 20.
Daniel Gutierrez on behalf of the California Attorneys for Criminal Justice in opposition.
Line 19.
Hi, this is Natasha Vanderhoof from the Sidewalk Project. My organization is strongly opposed to SB 350 because of the work that we do directly on the street at the front lines of the overdose crisis. I'm also a former opiate user, and I've lost a loved one, a romantic partner to opiate overdose. There's no empirical evidence that these...
Line 87. Line 87,
Hello,
your line is open. Yes.
Hello, my name is Rafaela O'Mara. I'm calling representing Inland Empire Harm Reduction, who serve drug users in Riverside County. And I'm also calling speaking on behalf of Zoe Westcott, who lost her husband, Taylor Brinkenhoff, to accidental fentanyl overdose on June 20th, 2020. We are strongly in opposition of SB 350. Thank you.
Line 13. Line 13, your line is open. Line 313. Line 313, your line is open.
Hi, my name is Petra Reyes. I work at the National Harm Reduction Coalition. Safer use, decriminalization, and a safer drug supply will save lives, not criminalizing and stigmatizing those impacted by drug use. I strongly oppose SB 350. Thank you.
Line 27. I'm going to move on to line 169. Line 318.
Danica Rodarmo on behalf of the San Francisco Public Defender's Office in opposition.
Line 302.
Hi, my name is Sonia Guerra from the Sidewalk Project.
Line 13.
Yes, thank you. This is Garrick Byers from the California Public Defenders Association. We oppose SB 350. Thank you.
Line 324. Line 324, your line is open. I'm going to move on
Hello?
To line 325.
In opposition to SB 350. Thank you.
Pardon me, line 325. Your line was not heard. Go ahead and repeat, please.
Hi, I'm Daniela Watke. I am a resident of Berkeley, and I'm calling in opposition to SB 350 and against overdoses. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, there is no one else in queue.
Moderator, I would just ask...
Pardon me, we may have...
Check the lines one more time for those in opposition of SB 350. One more time.
This final call for those who wish to speak in opposition to this bill, please press 1 then 0. Line 259, your line is open. To move on to line 198.
Good morning to the chair and members of the committee. Jim Lindbergh on behalf of the Friends Committee on Legislation of California in opposition to SB 350. Thank you.
Line 188.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, hi, I'm Shannon Knox. I'm the director of training at Community Health Project Los Angeles, and I also oversee overdose education and naloxone distribution with the county. I am speaking on behalf of overdead that grief make laws evidence should. And I echo everyone who speaks in opposition of this bill.
Mr. Chair, there is no one else who signaled that they wish to speak.
Thank you. At this time, we're going to bring it back to the committee, and we're going to open it up for questions or discussions as it relates to this matter. Are there any questions or concerns from any member on this bill? Senator Ochoa-Bulk.
I do. Mr. Chair, thank you for the opportunity to speak on this matter, and I would like to thank the author for bringing this measure forward. I'm a proud co-author of this measure, and I would like to express my gratitude for this important bill that you have brought forth, and to the parents here present, the family members who have lost loved ones accidentally through the overdose of the fentanyl overdose. My sincere condolences. Just an observation. I noticed many of you folks mentioned the age of your children, and it just so happens that my children are pretty much the same age as yours. So I just cannot imagine the situation that you're in. This issue, the fentanyl epidemic, has been ravaging the Southern California region in recent years. It hits home in Senate District 23, which is the district that I represent on this committee. There were 227 fentanyl-related deaths in Riverside County in 2020 alone. And in recent months, 50% of all the overdose deaths in Los Angeles County have been attributed to fentanyl. Fentanyl is a synthetic opiate that can be formulated to be 50 times more potent than heroin. And fatal fentanyl overdoses occur at a mere couple thousandths of a gram. Oftentimes, the user of these drugs have no knowledge that the drugs they are consuming contain this dangerous substance, and far too many have lost their lives as a result. This constitutes more than negligence on the manufacturer's behalf and should be treated like the serious offense that it is. SB 350 is one small step in the right direction towards addressing this epidemic. It is a warning, just like a warning when you get a DUI, and it lets the person that's been convicted of the DUI to let them know that if they continue in that path, that their actions would have serious consequences, including the loss of life. This is what this bill does. It gives a warning to those who manufacture and who sell these drugs to let them know that if they continue in that practice, that their actions have serious consequences. Consequences which you here in this in the Capitol and those who called are unfortunate victims of that circumstance. It is with that understanding that it is just a warning, just the beginning step, that I wholeheartedly support this bill and request for your I vote and move it when the time comes, when it's appropriate.
Thank you. Senator Weiner.
Excuse me. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And first of all, I want to thank all of the parents, grandparents, friends who came out today, either physically or on the phone, to talk about the horrific tragedy that you've experienced. That is not easy. It's not easy. I know, having experienced loss in my family, it is very hard to talk about. And so I want to thank you for doing that. Yesterday I had a Zoom with a group of parents, because I think it's very important for me to have that direct communication, and I appreciate them taking the time and our being able to have a very candid difficult dialogue about this issue. I reviewed every single email that I received on this, and I appreciate also whoever put together the booklet with the beautiful pictures of these young people and their stories, and I reviewed that cover to cover, and it was absolutely heartbreaking. This whole situation is it's such a deep tragedy, and it's getting worse. As I mentioned to the group I spoke with yesterday in San Francisco last year, more than 700 people died of overdose deaths last year. They were not all fentanyl, but a significant percentage were. It was a record and nearly double the previous record. San Francisco is on track to break the record again this year if the first few months are indicative of the rest of the year, which I suspect that tragically they will be. And every single one of these individuals, whether they are 15, whether they're 30, whether they're 60 years old, these are all human beings. These are our family members, our friends, our neighbors, and they have families, and they and their lives matter. And we are failing right now. And fentanyl is just it's a despicable substance, and it is just harming so many people. If this bill and increasing the penalties, because it is a warning, but it's a warning that is specifically designed to increase the possibility of ultimately prosecuting and convicting someone of murder. If this were an effective way of reducing drug use, reducing drug dealing, it would be something to talk about and consider. But I don't believe that it will. And the reason that I say that is we have done this before. We have gone through long periods of time in this country of incarcerating drug dealers, including low-level drug dealers, for long, long periods of time. Drug dealers whose dealing led to death or not, putting them away for years or decades. And that did not solve the problem. It did not reduce drug use. It did not reduce overdoses. Drug use and overdose are much worse now than they were before we adopted those harsh penalties. So putting more people away for long periods of time is not going to reduce the supply of drugs. As long as there is demand, the supply will be there, and the dealers will be there. And we need to take better approaches to actually address this issue. We continue to prevent harm reduction and to prohibit harm reduction methods that have been proven to actually help. It is actually still illegal in California to provide someone with a fentanyl strip so that they can actually swab and test their drugs to see if fentanyl is in it. That's illegal right now in California. So there are a lot of things that we need to do to save lives. I just don't think that this having longer sentences and putting people in jail for a long period of time, it's not going to prevent any overdoses. And I think that is a false hope, and so I will not be supporting the bill today.
I'm out of here.
Thank you. Thank you. And we're going to ask you to restrain your comments, really. We respected every witness here, whatever your position was, we respected it. So we expect the same of you. Then bye. Then bye.
See you later. You don't get
bye.
It's a poison that got an overdose.
Senator Skinner, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Senator Melendez, my understanding is there were, not understanding, I see it in the analysis and in the materials, that there were some amendments offered. And as far as my read of the amendments, that if they were included in the bill would do what you described, which is give a warning, and that the bill without those amendments does more than just the warning. It additionally provides a direction, in effect, that might substantiate an additional, or rather a justification for prosecutorial action. Now, I appreciate that that the supporters of the bill would like to see that potentially. However, I think it's important for in any court case for motives and such to be determined in the process of the determination in the court hearing. And if we compare this to, for example, the DUI warnings, they do not have that element. And so I wonder if you would take the amendment, because I could support the bill with the committee's amendments.
Thank you, Senator Skinner.
And with the committee's amendments, there still is the warning. Just wanted to be clear on the record, but go ahead.
Thank you, Senator Skinner. So the amendment that was offered by the committee was to remove the implied malice from the bill and just have the advisement read to the individual that this type of behavior could cause result in the death of another human being. So it really took the guts of the bill away, because at this point in time, when someone is before a court and before a judge, it is inevitable that that judge is going to indicate to that person that this type of behavior you're engaging in is harmful. It's going to hurt someone. That's why they're there before the judge. So telling the judge to communicate that to the person, it doesn't do anything. That's why we have the implied malice in the bill as a warning, as an advisement. And I just want to stress that it's not a guarantee that someone would be charged with murder. It's an option. It's not mandatory. Some DAs may not choose to go that route. Others may find circumstances in which they find that that's appropriate. It's not designed for liberal use. It's designed for very judicious use. But for me to remove the part of the bill that is the heart of the bill, which is the ability to use the implied malice, I could not agree to removing that from the bill and only have a bill that says the judge should read to the defendant what you're doing is dangerous. I think they're already doing that. So unfortunately, I could not accept that amendment.
In your close, you made...
We're sorry. Your conference will end in 5 minutes.
In your close, you made the analogy to the warning that is given in the drunk driving cases. And the drunk driving cases do not include that malice. And so you used that analogy, and which is an analogy that I agree with and I think would accomplish much of what you are trying to achieve, especially if we are making that comparison. However, that addition, which you now say makes your bill not useful, then you can't really make it and the analogy towards what we have allowed in statute on drunk driving. So I think it, again, I think that the committee's recommendation is reasonable. And as you know, all of our bills, the whole point of a committee process and of our committee's consultants who have many years of experience in whatever the field is that is of the committee's concern. And in this case, in public safety, we have consultants who have are not only extremely familiar with all of California's statutes, but also judicial processes, prosecutorial processes, and others. And I think their recommendations have value. And I cannot speak for my other colleagues, but I suspect that this bill would be successful if the committee's amendments were taken. Most of us don't expect to ever have any of our bills fly through without some level of amendment.
Senator Skinner, I couldn't agree with you more, and I have made numerous compromises on bills that I've brought before the Senate and for the Assembly. We all have to do it. No one gets their bill through generally on the first pass. What the committee asked me to do, though, essentially was to turn in a bill that says a judge needs to advise someone that the behavior they're engaging in could kill another human being. That's it. We don't need a law to do that. A judge is already doing that when a defendant is in front of them.
To the statute that you described as that you are trying to mirror.
I'm sorry, say again?
That is what is in the advisory under a DUI case. So you used the analogy of your intention to put into statute that which we do in DUI cases.
That's incorrect. The bill, that's just not correct. And I'm sorry if there's some misunderstanding in the discussions you have had about this bill, but that's simply not correct. It is designed to allow a prosecutor on a subsequent indictment to use the implied malice in the event they want to use a murder charge. They don't have to, but it gives them the option. That's what the bill does. That's part of the advisement when they tell them, you know, you could be charged with murder, and that's what the bill does. So I don't know. I'm not sure you and I are going to be able to resolve this in the few minutes we have left in this committee hearing, but I want to assure you that my goal is not to make it more punitive than necessary, or more punitive perhaps than what we have already set up for DUI convictions.
However, it does. So it is not analogous to what we have established in the DUI.
Well,
and we have existing statute that if there is, in fact, proven to be malice, and if there is knowledge that there was fentanyl.
We're sorry. Your conference will end in 1.
And if there is knowledge by the dealer that there was fentanyl in the substance, they can be charged with, and the analysis cites the various statutes that are on the books that allow such. And I, as I indicated, could support the addition of the warning as you used in the close, but not the additional phrasing, which is not in our statute regarding DUIs. And
Senator Kalmager.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to applaud Senator Melendez for organizing all of these families. I'm putting together this packet, which I did read, so I'm going to give you and your office the credit for putting it together. And I also want to salute the families for showing up and for calling in and sharing your stories about your loved ones who were lost to this drug. You know, I wish we didn't have to ask families and friends to relive these moments, because I am sure that it cannot be easy for you to do so. And this, I think, happens to be a committee where so often family members from all sides are asked to relive painful moments and experiences and circumstances. This bill does open the door for prosecutors to charge dealers, sellers, however that is defined, with manslaughter or murder. And, you know, accidental drug overdose, and I believe that most overdoses are accidental, in my mind, does not equate manslaughter or murder. What drug overdose is, however...
We're going to ask you to contain yourselves. If you can't, you're going to be asked to leave the room.
What?
Leave the room, then. Leave the room.
What drug overdose is sad and unfortunate, and it is something that we should be talking about openly and without stigma. We over-medicate, we self-diagnose, we stigmatize depression, and we do it all in the silence of darkness. And we collectively are at fault for not having much more open discussions about all of those issues. A number of family members on the phone who spoke in support of the bill said, "Fentanyl is the murderer. Fentanyl is the murderer." And if that is the case, I would fully support us putting fentanyl on trial. We certainly should. Absolutely 100%. As my colleague from San Francisco said, that the war on drugs has not been proven to work. And expensive, counterproductive over-incarceration policies also do not work. How do we find the righteous middle that works for everyone? As hard as this is to say, and I have to remind myself of it all the time, you know, justice and retribution are not always the same thing. And it is not in the interest of policymakers to create policy that doesn't really understand that. This bill's not going to bring back loved ones. People on the phone also mentioned that. It's not going to address the fact that people continue to experiment with drugs. It's not going to address the fact that people continue to get drugs that are unregulated. It doesn't address any of that. And when we are purchasing drugs off the market, there is risk. We should be talking about that as well. This bill doesn't address the issues about the distribution chain. If someone is selling and then they're no longer selling, maybe they've had a come to Jesus moment. They've been doing this. They've stopped doing it for a very long time, but their product happens to be on the market. Or someone then takes that up and starts doing it. Does it address that circumstance? Does it address if you're selling and you don't even know what you're selling? You've just been caught up in this and you're being told to do something because of some other circumstance. Does it address that? Does it address the fact that maybe you've gone to the black market to buy an unregulated product because you're not willing to or you can't purchase a regulated pill? All of those are policy issues that should be included if you're going to essentially open the door to allow someone to be charged with murder. If I would be willing to accept and support this bill if the amendments, the committee amendments, were accepted, and if it comes up if during this process that is still an option, I would be very willing to support this bill. But in its current form right now, unfortunately, I will not be able to do so.
Thank you, Senator Kamlager. I think we've heard from all the members of the committee, and I too want to commend Senator Melendez for bringing this measure forward. But as been articulated, there are some challenges. It's not a single member of this committee and this legislative body in California or probably across this nation who doesn't sympathize and empathize with family members who have lost someone, who friends, to drug overdose. We all know someone who has lost a loved one. We've probably personally have lost a loved one from drug overdose. But what is missing here, as I think some of the senators have tried to articulate, there is a level of culpability from the user.
You're a fucking idiot. And my son was not a drug user.
And what we need to understand, this is about drug use. Whether it's illegal street drugs or pharmaceutical drugs, prescribed to a user by that's I should say that's not prescribed by a healthcare professional, there's inherent risk in doing so. Even from legal drugs, we have plenty of examples of individuals who've had prescribed drugs and their kid or their neighbor or someone gets into their medical cabinet, takes those drugs, and they die of those that use as well. So we have plenty of examples of people using legal drugs and overdosing. So we've offered up amendments to this bill that I think would send a strong message to deter these drug-related fatalities. We have, and I'm committed to doing that. However, providing law enforcement with yet another tool to give longer sentences, we know, history has shown, that does not deter drug sales. It doesn't deter crime whatsoever. All we do is incarcerate people, and as I think the senator from San Francisco stated, it's a supply and demand. So you lock someone up for 50 years, it's going to be someone quickly that very next day to take that place and continue to sell these drugs. So these policies only exacerbate the disparities, as we stated, as race as it relates to our criminal justice system. So we know all the harm on the war on drugs. And like I said, we all sympathize with anyone who has lost a loved one on this. I think we have a measure, we have an amendment that allows you to achieve your goal and objective here. And to equate this to the DUI warning is clear, but it's a little different as well with the DUI. On a DUI, you warn somebody, you get behind the wheel again and somebody dies. Yes, you can be charged with manslaughter, you can be charged with murder because you knowingly, because you had an innocent person there. But again, there's a level of culpability in selling someone an illegal drug and me as the purchaser taking it and then having some level of responsibility for buying something illegal. So there are two different scenarios here. So on that measure, if you're not willing to take the amendment, or I should say if you are willing to take the amendment, I'd be more than happy to support your measure today. But without that, I too cannot be supporting this bill today. So I will afford you your opportunity to close.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Skinner.
Thank you for the close. Thank you, Chair, for that explanation. But I also want to just make sure that I don't want people to feel we are talking past each other, because there is in statute now, as is described in the analysis, that if a person knowingly sells any of these substances, that they knowingly have fentanyl, and there is then a death. There are multiple circumstances for which that person can be charged with manslaughter or with other charges related to the death of the person who took the substance. And those are on the books, and it's cited in the analysis. And the warning part, even with the amendments, if you were to take them, requires then the warning to say what the possible future criminal liability is, that there is criminal liability under existing law. And the bill without the amendments doesn't necessarily create a whole new statute for new criminal liability. It just can create a circumstance in whatever the next circumstance is for the prosecutor to be able to use intention. And so what we are trying to avoid, we are not trying to eliminate any current statute that would put the person who sold it in a criminal liability situation. They are still in that situation. And in terms of supporting the amendments, we are supporting your intent to make sure that a person does have that warning and understands that there is criminal liability and understands that there are statutes on the books that can lead to their conviction if there is a death in such case. So I just wanted for the record, because I feel that those family members who've come here in support, that the bill, if amended, still gives a great deal of, it achieves much of what the intent is. So I just wanted to put that on the record and make sure that we weren't just talking over each other.
May I close?
Mayor Melendez.
Yes, may I close now?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Members, I want to thank all of you for your comments, and thank you for the time taking the time to listen to all of those who testified today in support of this bill. I would also like to point out that this bill wasn't crafted out of thin air. I didn't just come up with this just out of the blue one night. This bill, the way it is written today, was crafted with the help of district attorneys who said this is the way in which this bill needs to be worded so that we can do what we need to do in order to get these drug dealers off the street. That is why it is worded the way it is. So I just want to make sure everyone understands that. Implied malice is not, it's not a new idea, okay? Implied malice and drug-related deaths is not a new idea. 20 states now have drug-induced homicide laws that carry the same sentences as murder and manslaughter, and there are more states that are considering it. I'd like to address some of the claims that the opposition made. This is not a mandatory murder charge. This is an advisement, a warning. You get a second chance. The next time, if you continue in this behavior and your behavior causes someone to die, you could be charged with the murder. It's not automatic. Again, it depends on the DA. It is to be used with discretion, just like it is with DUI cases. It is not designed to be used every time you have somebody in front of you. And we're not talking about the friend who gives someone a pill, the low-level dealer. We're talking, district attorneys want to go after the big guys, okay? The mass distributors. That's who we're talking about. We're not talking about going after every tiny little low-level drug dealer. That is not the purpose of this bill. There was a witness who testified in opposition that made the claim that more people would now refuse to call 911 in the event that somebody was having an issue. That is a ridiculous claim. That we have good Samaritan laws for lots of things in California. And if someone gets in a car accident, are they going to now say, oh, I'm not going to call 911 because maybe they'll blame me for the car? That's ridiculous. That is absurd on its face. And by the way, the good Samaritan laws are in place for exactly this type of reason, so that someone could make the phone call to save someone's life. And no, they're not going to be charged. So that's just flat out false. Drug dealers do have a financial incentive, though, to pack fentanyl into these pills designed to look like prescription medication. They're putting them in Percocet, they're putting them in Oxy, they're putting them in Adderall. Okay, this goes down to middle school. 14-year-old kids, we're talking 14-year-old kids, and you get on Snapchat and you can order it? I mean, come on. Come on. They do it because it's financially advantageous. We all know that. The possibility of possibly being charged with murder for engaging in that type of activity, that might be perhaps enough incentive to get at least some of them out of dealing drugs that are laced with fentanyl. I'm not suggesting that this is the answer. I know it's not. And, you know, we've had lengthy conversations about the fact that we need more services for people who have addiction. And I have voted for bills that do just that. I have done that. I recognize that. The answer isn't to always throw someone in prison because they have an addiction. The better answer is to get their life back on track. I recognize that, and I've agreed with all of you on that, and I voted for those types of bills. But this has to be a partnership between enforcement and rehabilitation and services. It's not just one tool in the toolbox. It's not just one big hammer. There are lots of ways that we can solve this problem, but we can't help everyone with the same tools. You know, we have people who are addicted to drugs. That is separate from the casual user. That's separate from the 14-year-old in middle school whose friend tells them, oh, you know, we've got finals coming up, and I took this last night, and it really helped me focus and stay awake. Here, take this Adderall, and the 14-year-old takes it, and he gets the one with fentanyl in it. That 14-year-old doesn't need to go to rehabilitation. He doesn't have a drug problem. He took it one time. That's what we're talking about. This is, it's a complex problem, absolutely. But I just, I feel like it was a narrow view today of how we try to address this issue. I hope that you all did have a chance to look through this book. I know, Senator Weiner, you said, I believe it was you, said you had a chance to look there. I hope you have a chance to look through it. Because, again, it's just, it doesn't know any racial boundaries. It doesn't know age limits, nothing. But one pill, half a pill in some cases, and that's it. You don't wake up. I know we want to wrap this hearing up, so I will just say that I am thankful to the people who came to testify today. I know it was hard. I want you to think about the things they said. I want you to think about their experiences. I want you to think about the things that I've said. And I know some of you have expressed reservations about this bill. But I am asking you, I am begging you, on behalf of everybody who testified today and the people who are going to go through this tomorrow or by the end of the day today, and when they go to bed tonight, there's going to be one less person in their family for them to hug. I'm asking you to think about that, and I'm asking for your aye vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Melendez, for your presentation here today on SB 350. I know it was a difficult presentation for all of us, and again, we want to thank all the witnesses who have come before us today to testify in support as well as in opposition. We have a motion from Senator Ochoa Bogue. It is a due pass to appropriations. Madam Secretary, please call the roll.
SB 350, due pass to appropriations. Bradford? Ochoa Bogue?
Aye.
Ochoa Bogue, aye. Kamlager? Skinner? Weiner? Weiner, no. The vote's 1-1.
It's 1-1. That measure fails. It will be granted reconsideration if the author chooses.
We have a couple things on call.
Oh, yes. Can we lift the call first on consent item, consultant?
Okay, consent calendar, Kamlager? Kamlager, aye. That's out 5-0.
That measure's out. Consent